you see. This person, if you tell him, don't smoke, smoking is haram, he might rebel, and in order for him to avoid you, he will not even come to the masjid anymore. So what have you done? Yani, you have turned him into someone abandoning the masjid. And that's a bigger crime than even smoking. Okay. At least the masjid, sometimes later might remind him, you see, soften his heart, you know, he might hear something good in the masjid. But now you have made him run away. He doesn't want to see you, because if he sees you, you will tell him smoking is haram. Okay? So be gentle. Be gentle with others, you see. You see that person, is it suitable for me to tell him this now or not? I remember a brother whom I gave shahada, American brother, and next week I heard he rejected Islam. So they told me the story, they said, those who took this brother with them, they insisted on him to do something, which is a sunnah, okay? Not even part of wudu, and he could not take it, so he left Islam altogether. Okay. Actually, in the same night that I gave him shahada, we sat down for dinner. One of those brothers said to this brother, don't eat with your left, eat with your right. Don't sit like this. The brother doesn't even know to sit on the ground. This is his whole life, he's not sitting on the ground. Don't sit like this, brother, you sit like this. And don't eat with your left. Then a third person said, I have the etiquettes of eating in my car. I'll bring the list. 35 lists, 35 things. You see, the man just said, la ilaha illallah. He doesn't know how to make the five prayers. No. Another one said, I have the etiquettes of sleeping. Wallah. And he went to the car and brought, I took both of them and I said, Ya Akhi, be gentle with the man, be. Take it easy, Ya Akhi. SubhanAllah. And they took him from me, because to them I was not part of their group, so they took him. And they said, we'll take care of him. And after a week I heard he rejected Islam. So, also amongst the basira, the insight, is the priorities. The first priority is to call to Tawheed. There is no other priority which comes before it, you see. If you are calling people who already have Tawheed, then you can go to the next and to the next. Otherwise, you start with Tawheed. I know one of the leaders of the biggest groups nowadays who call to Islam and who are sincere to give da'wah to Islam. He used to delay all aspects of Tawheed and Shirk. He used to say, no, those issues will divide us. Now let's concentrate on removing the rulers. Okay? And this is not the way, this is not the priority, you see. So, our da'wah means we want people to worship Allah alone, to obey Allah. We don't want to achieve our own goals, you see. This is not da'wah to Allah. As the author mentioned here in some of his comments, he said a lot of people who call to Allah are actually calling to themselves. You see. They are calling to themselves, not to Allah. You see. Because if you call to Allah, be like Ibrahim alayhi salam. He started with Tawheed. Be like Noah. Noah, for 950 years, was calling them to Tawheed only. 950 years. And his followers were only 12. 950 years. Those who were with him on the ship, 12. 12 humans. Of course, there were some animals and things other than that, Allah, but only 12, you see. Yeah. So we'll finish, inshallah, this chapter next time, which is the call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the call to Tawheed. هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. If there are any questions or comments, ayyakum.
See, he said this word, basira.
No. Basira, insight.
Insight.
Yeah, insight. From basar. Basar is sight.
Sight.
Sight, yeah. Basira, insight. No.
I have a question about apostates. What is the methodology of dealing with them? Do we do takfir? Sure, we do the repentance thing, you know? Or do we do repentance then takfir? You know, and how to do we deal with them out of Islamic jurisprudence? Open the books of jurisprudence.
Those who, yani, those Muslims who reject the faith as individuals, we become gentle to them and call them back to Islam in the best way. The ruler is the one who is assigned for the legal issues. You see, it's not us. And this is a big point nowadays. A lot of people confuse their duties with the duties of everyone else, you see. They want to do the duties of scholars, give fatwa. You cannot give fatwa. They want to do the duties of rulers. They want to execute people and kill them. Yeah, it's not yours. You see, in Islam, everything is organized. The fatwa for those who are eligible to give fatwa. Execution of the punishment is for the ruler only. Not for me and you, otherwise there will be chaos, revenges, and everything, you know, will be very bad, you see. If I execute some of your brothers because he did something bad, then you are going to revenge from me, and things will never end, you see. But if the ruler does it, and he does it because he knows that person deserves it, that's it, it stops, you see. So the point is that if someone rejects Islam after he has become a Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ said, "من بدل دينه فاقتلوا." He who switches Islam, his Islam to another religion, then kill him. But this is not for everyone to execute, you see. This is the general rule, you see. This person should be brought. He should be advised gently and all that. If he is not convinced, that's it. We've done our part, you see. The ruler can bring him and try to bring him back to Islam. And if he doesn't, the ruler can threaten him. Look, I'm gonna kill you. If you don't become a Muslim, I'll kill you. Okay. Then that's up to the ruler, but not me and you.
We tend to forget the best way to teach someone is by example.
Yes.
Because when, right, I know it works with me, because you tell me you're going to kill me, I'm going to tell you, go for it. Plain and simple.
I will defend myself.
Because I'm not afraid to die, because I'm right with myself.
Right.
And if you're fool enough to try, you're going to get hurt. The other thing is, the best thing is example. Because of my size, I think, or whatever reason, people who have been trying to help me have been going, yeah, this is what we need to do. Don't worry about it, I'll show you. Don't worry about it, if you don't get it right the first time, watch me, I'll show you. That gets my attention. That lets me know that they're not telling me to do something they're not doing. That is the best teaching tool going.
Yeah.
But if you tell a Westerner that you're going to kill him, he's going to come at you.
No, no, I'm not speaking about non-Muslims. I'm speaking about someone who's been a Muslim all his life. My duty as a regular individual is only to give him advice, you see. But when it comes to the ruler who has the authority, he can go beyond the advice. He can tell him, you know, right in the face. This is our ruling in Islam. The Prophet said this, okay. So if he accepts, alhamdulillah. If he doesn't accept, let him die if he's not afraid of death. That's it.
But he can lie and go to another country. That's under the
Torah. Huh?
You
He what?
He can lie about, you know.
That's up to him.
And go to another country.
That's up to him. The Prophet ﷺ
did, space.
The Prophet ﷺ did not kill the hypocrites.
Yeah.
The hypocrites were not faithful, but they were just saying by tongue they are faithful.
Yes.
So they were left. We are not any judges on the heart. You see? We cannot open his heart and say, okay, you're lying. No.
Yeah.
If he says I'm faithful, and khalas, that's it. You see. And the Prophet ﷺ was the ruler in Medina. He could have killed all the hypocrites. He didn't. Even those who said very bad things about him, he did not kill them. Because he thought, at this moment, if I kill them, others who look at us from outside think that they are my companions. And they would take the wrong message that Muhammad cannot stand any difference from anyone. If you differ with him, he'll kill you. So that will be a repeller from the accepting Islam, you see. So the Prophet ﷺ would not even kill the hypocrite who accused his wife of being a fornicator, right? He did not kill him because the man denied it. So he said, okay.
I have a question about hadith that you mentioned about whoever that is in my ummah and heard about me. So there's two conditions for this hadith. If one of the conditions that does not exist, the example of people in China, when the timeline of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, people knew and Islam is not expanded, what is the condition, what is the hukum upon this book?
Anyone who comes in the hereafter without having heard about Islam, he will be treated with a special group in the hereafter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send a messenger to them in the hereafter. And this is mentioned by the Prophet ﷺ. Okay, Ahlul Fatrah. Yeah. Those who did not hear anything about the truth, they will be included in this special group. On the Day of Judgment, after being resurrected, a messenger will be sent to them. Yes. But there, the messenger will order them with something which is very difficult for them, because they have seen everything. Okay. So if they accept and follow him, they will go to paradise. Otherwise, they will go to hell.
How about takfirs, about the people that do takfir to everyone else, no reason. There is a verse that they use often. Whoever that does not fall by the rule of Allah, those are the kafirs. And this is a very literal verse.
Again, it's because of their misunderstanding of this verse. Yani if I want to apply this verse to them with their understanding, I would declare them kafirs. According to their false understanding, I will declare them kafirs. Why? Because I can prove to them that they are not ruling with the rule of Allah in many things.
Yeah.
You see? Yeah. So why only apply it to kings and presidents and those people? This is a general verse. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ وَمَنْ means everyone. Right? It's not only for the 50 Muslim rulers, you see. And also, we have explanations by the companions of this verse. And Abdullah ibn Abbas said, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ جُحُودًا لِحُكْمِ اللَّهِ فَهُوَ كَافِرٌ وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ غَيْرُ جَاهِلٍ فَهُوَ كُفْرٌ دُونَ كُفْرٍ أَوْ كُفْرٌ لَا يُخْرُجُ مِنَ الْمِلَّةِ. He who rules with other than the rule of Allah, provided that he is denying the truthfulness of the rule of Allah, then he is a kafir. He who rules with other than the rule of Allah, admitting that what he is doing is wrong and not denying the truthfulness of the rule of Allah, then it is not the great kufr which will take him out of Islam. And all the scholars agree on this. Except those people who misunderstand Quran and misunderstand Hadith and misunderstand the statements of the companions. Yeah, and if you tell them this, they say, well, you have Abdullah ibn Abbas and we have Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. We say, okay, what did Abdullah ibn Mas'ud say? They say, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, when he was asked about the bribery, he said, it's a great sin, suhd. So when they said, how about if the bribery is from the ruler? He said, it is kufr. Now, they understand this to mean what? That when bribery is done by the ruler, then it is kufr. Who says this? This is the way of Khawarij. Bribery is a sin. Whether he does it or anyone else does it. Bribery is a sin, you see. But by kufr he means the small kufr. You see, not the great kufr. Because the companions took their knowledge directly from the Prophet. He told them, there is a small shirk. Okay. When, as narrated in Sahih al-Bukhari, when the Prophet ﷺ said, I saw hellfire and I saw most of its occupants to be women. They said, why, O Messenger of Allah? He said, yakfurna. They commit kufr. So, companions know that there is great kufr and there is small kufr which does not take you out of Islam. So they said, O Messenger of Allah, what type of kufr is it? Is it that or this? And the Prophet ﷺ said, no, the smaller one. Okay. Kufr here means denying the favor of the husband. Kufr, as we mentioned earlier, is cover in English. Cover comes from kufr because al-kufr wa taqiyah, to cover. Put the seed in the sand and cover it with the sand. You are doing kufr to the seed, okay? You are covering it, okay? So covering the truth, okay, with falsehood.
They are this covering is, the virtues of the husband or something like that?
They are, they are denying the favors of the husband. يعني, this now happens from both men and women. يعني, a woman could be doing so much good to her husband, and all of a sudden, he is not in the mood, and he tells her, I have never seen any good from you. You see? This is the meaning of it, okay? But at that time, women were doing it more, you see? Mm-hmm. Now, Allah Alam is doing it more. Maybe the men, maybe the women.
But is it okay to give a bribe to have your rights?
Not until you are doing it out of necessity, and it will save your life. Or save you from prison, for example. Mm-hmm. Yani, you go to Syria, you cannot do anything without bribing, okay? You have to bribe the people there, and, you know, to
yes.
The military man, the policeman, this man, that man, everywhere, almost in most of the Arab countries, okay? If you don't have to go there, don't go. You don't need this humiliation, okay? But if you have to for some necessity, then what choice do you have, you see? He'll take the responsibility of taking the bribe. You see?
But here in Kuwait we need wasta. No wasta.
Yeah, here now it's starting to flourish also in the name of wasta also and all this.
So it's like good wasta and bad wasta, haram wasta and halal wasta.
Yeah, of course. Wasta means shafa'ah. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَمَنْ يَشْفَى شَفَاعَةً حَسَنًا. There is a shafa'ah hasana, which means you have a right and you cannot take your right except by someone with a position who can go and seek it, okay? Then you are taking your right. This is okay. And he will be rewarded by Allah, okay? But if I go and make wasta for you to take someone else's right, then this is shafa'ah sayyi'ah. Yeah. This is a bad wasta, okay?
Actually, yeah. The mechanism of wasta, as I've experienced it, that you do a favor to someone that knows that he will need you.
Yeah,
so it's trading the favor.
This is not good. This is not legal. Yani, you don't do a wasta, which is intercession for someone, to gain something from him. If you do it for gaining something from him, this is evil. This is not good. Okay.
That's what they do.
They do more than that.
Yes. But when you do the wasta, you take the place not allowed for you. I think this is the place for
Sahih.
For
Sahih.
Another person. Sahih. He needed. You do the wasta to take the place from him.
Yeah,
or the work from him, for example.
Yeah. Contract from him.
Yeah, contract or something like that. So the wasta is not good.
Good for you.
If I'm Muslim, this is not good for me because I must wait and pray to God to get help.
Unfortunately, yeah, this society has been brought up on those bad things. To get what you don't deserve and all that. To get what you don't deserve. Yeah.